This episode is brought to you by Squarespace, the all-in-one platform to build a beautiful online presence like yours truly.
The hardest thing for a lot of people we're divorcing is the fights and the pain and the frustration.
I spent too much time with you, Daniel! It's over! It's over!
And it's devastating for everybody. This film, for all the ridiculous hijinks, is really about grief.
The truth is, I didn't like who I was when I was with him.
You have this dream, you have this life that you're going to build together, you have this family that you're going to create, and you're going to be together for the rest of your days, and then it doesn't work that way.
But if there's love, dear, those are the ties that bind.
The whole arc of Robin Williams' character in this is by being Mrs. Doubtfire, he becomes the parent he always should have been.
Thank you.
This scene makes me cry, because this is the way it should be. And whenever it is like this, it's beautiful.
It's great, yeah.
This episode was filmed before the writers and actors strike. Without their labor, our show wouldn't exist. We support their strike efforts. If you'd like to support them as well, go to www.entertainmentcommunity.org and donate.
Hello and welcome to Cinema Therapy. I'm Jonathan Decker, licensed therapist who loves movies. This is
Alan Seawright. I can't talk that fast, but I'm a professional filmmaker who needs some therapy.
Today we're going to be doing movie family therapy on Robin Williams, Sally Field, and co.
Mrs. Doubtfire.
Yes, Mrs. Doubtfire. Fantastic.
I love this movie. And you know what is so great about this movie? I loved it when I was a kid. And it still works.
It still
works.
Aside
from some slight homo and transphobia. But only a little bit. It's not as bad as you would think for 1993.
1993. And I was 12. We were both 12 when this came out. And holy crap, is this filthier than I remember.
So much dirtier. So dirty, guys.
Oh, dear. Well, they say a man who has to buy a big car like that's trying to compensate for smaller genitals, is he?
But still wholesome.
You've just described Robin Williams.
Wholesome.
So dirty, but so wholesome.
We miss you. We miss you, Robin.
I'm not going to cry, Roy.
We're going to be talking about divorce and co-parenting.
Mm-hmm.
And like many great comedies or fantasies, there is a component of emotional realism that kind of anchors the proceedings and all the chaos. And in this film, the scenes depicting divorce, co-parenting, blending families have actual depth, like real depth.
Yeah. And I'm really curious. I want to get your opinion on how, you know, realistic and believable some of that stuff is.
Yep. Let's do this.
Why am I the only one that feels there has to be rules?
Oh,
why do you always make me out to be the heavy?
Oh, I don't make you out to be anything. You do it yourself, quite naturally.
You set
Miranda.
Me up, Daniel, every time. Oh,
I don't set you. Oh, lighten up, will you?
The couples do this. One gets more serious and one gets more lighthearted. Like, they counter each other and they go way too far.
Yeah.
Daniel. It's over! It's over!
So have you had an it's over moment, like in a session before?
Where they realize in session that they don't have a marriage? Yeah.
Ooh, how?
Years.
We'll talk about that. I'm curious.
Listen, maybe we need some help, okay? Maybe we can go to a family therapist. They'll help us through this together.
I love that he realizes, oh, I've gone too far. I've got to actually back off.
Yeah.
Take a vacation together with the kids as a family. Get you away from work. You're a different person. You really are. You're great.
Condescending without realizing
Daniel,
it.
Our problems would be waiting for us right here when we got back.
We'll move.
And she's so used to the condescension that she just sidesteps it like whatever.
She's just like, yeah, I know what's happening here.
Okay.
We've just grown apart. We're different. We have nothing in common.
Oh, sure we do. We love each other. Come on, man. We love each other.
I love her playing, realizing I'm not in love with this man anymore. In
yeah.
That moment. It's so good.
Yeah.
Mm-mm.
I want a divorce.
We're family, you know?
Yeah, these kids are all really good, too.
I'm so sorry.
And she is sorry, because she still cares about him.
For sure, yeah.
But she also knows that she doesn't want to spend the rest of her life with him.
Absolutely.
Something strange happened while I was watching this. This came out in 93, we were 12 years old,
yep.
And Sally Field, to me at the time, was old and matronly. And I watched this to prepare for this episode. I'm like, Sally Field's gorgeous.
Sally Field can get it.
You asked if I've ever had that in session.
Yeah, that kind of either the explosion or the realization that we're ending it.
Yeah.
In session.
Explosions all the time.
Generally speaking, your goal is to prevent that.
Right. Well, and so I tell people when they come in, because he says, let's do a family therapist. And she says, it's too late for that.
Yeah.
A lot of people come to therapy when it's in the 11th hour. And they come to me when they say, we're probably going to get a divorce, but we want to say that we did everything we could. So
we tried.
Fix it.
See? We checked off the box.
Oh, it drives me nuts. But the thing is, my bias, I became a couples therapist because I want to help couples stay together. But sure, that's not always what happens. And at that point, you pivot. And you pivot to what this movie takes 2 hours getting to, which is a healthy place where we're focused on what's good for the kids and we're leaving behind the problems of the past.
So one thing I noticed is that in this scene, he immediately goes into problem-solving mode.
Yeah.
Instead of listening mode.
Yeah.
Do you think that's part of the problem here?
Did yes.
the writers just nail that?
He's saying we should go on vacation, you should work less. He's still externalizing it to her.
It's her problem for the most part.
Yeah. You have this dream, you have this life that you're going to build together, you have this family that you're going to create, and you're going to be together for the rest of your days, and then it doesn't work that way.
Right.
And it's devastating, and it's devastating for everybody. I think it's so beautiful. Like, this film, for all the ridiculous hijinks, is really about grief.
Yeah.
It's about the grieving process of a big transition like that for everybody involved and how do we get there.
Have you seen our new Cinema Therapy website? We just launched it a few months ago and it was so easy to build and customize it using, you guessed it, Squarespace. Squarespace has so many templates to choose from with a wide variety of styles and formats for your site that you're building for you. Not for us, we already built one using Squarespace. So once we found a template that worked for us, we added our own color, fonts, and personal touches to make it our own brand and style. It's just like finding the perfect wig, costume, and prosthetics if you want your website to look like a lady. Fluid Engine, the design system from Squarespace, makes it really easy to customize the templates to your own personal specifications. They have built-in tools like video blocks and extensions for lots of platforms, so it was really easy for us to make our website into a hub that connects to our YouTube, our Patreon, our merch store, our popcorn store, our wig shop. We don't have one. Whether you need to build a website for your nanny services company, your TV show, or your law firm specializing in divorce and father's rights, Squarespace has a template that will work as a starting point perfectly for you. I guarantee it. That is an Alan Seawright personal guarantee. I will give you your money back if you are not satisfied. We're all busy people and don't want to spend months designing a website. Who has the time for that? Web designer, I hardly know her. But all of Squarespace's resources, like pre-built layouts, transferred domains, customizable templates, and the Squarespace Help Center, make it super easy and simple to build a website the way you want. Check out squarespace.com for a free trial, and when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/cinematherapy to get 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. Squarespace. You think space is round, but it isn't. It's square.
Mrs. Doubtfire, may I ask you a question?
Oh, sir.
How long after Mr. Doubtfire passed away,
Winston,
did you feel any desire?
Never.
Never.
Never again.
Never again?
Once the father of your children is out of the picture, the only solution is total and lifelong celibacy. And if you violate that, heaven forgive you. Good luck.
Robin Williams obviously is a complete genius. I don't know how much of that was improvised. I know while shooting the movie, basically they would do one or two takes as written.
Yeah.
So they'd get a version.
They get coverage of the script.
They'd get coverage as written, and then the director, Chris Columbus, would just be like, and Robin, because, like, he's so good. Sally Field crushes in that scene.
Yeah.
Because him saying all of that stuff, like, it's such a weird line to walk where it's like, I'm listening to this woman, and I like her, and I'm sort of taking her seriously, but this is insane.
Yeah.
But maybe she's, I don't know.
Like, I'm newly divorced. Like, my world is spinning. Maybe she knows. Maybe she's right. I don't
know. She's so smart about everything else. She's doing all these wonderful things. It's like, maybe she knows. She's playing such a weird mix of emotions, and she's doing it so well that it makes everything work, because that should not fly. That was dumb, but it was brilliant.
I wanted to talk about Sabbath, like when your ex starts to move on.
Yeah.
This is a funny scene, but if you strip away like the theatrics of it, it's very serious. I'm trying to undermine your future.
Yes.
Right? I feel hurt because you left me, hurt because you broke my heart, hurt because this, that, or the other. And this is petty and childish and superhuman.
The most human thing. Oh, you can never be with another man.
Yeah, right? Now, if I can't have you, nobody will. That's scary stalker stuff. But like, just dialing it back a couple notches from that is just, I can't bear to see you.
It's the most human thing ever.
Yeah. The hardest thing for a lot of people is the fights and the pain and the frustration and all the differences that led to the dissolution of the marriage. They just keep it going.
Yeah.
So in that case, it's like they're still married and still bickering, even though, and that's what I always tell people. I'm like, why did you get divorced? I actually do that in therapy. I go, why did you get divorced? And they're like, they list all the reasons. I say, yeah, but you're still doing that.
You're still doing that. So what? Now you're doing that with separate bank accounts and you have to pay more taxes.
Right. I thought.
Real smart.
I thought if you were going to get divorced, it would be so that could be done. So why are we still doing this? And people always go, huh.
Huh. When you put it that way, it makes me sound really dumb.
Dumb but human, which is synonymous.
It's yeah. It's like your computer is a wet sack of meat.
Such a gross phrase.
It was Daniel's spontaneity and his energy I fell in love with.
Really?
Everyone else I knew was so organized, so scheduled. Like me, I guess. Daniel was so wonderfully different and funny. He could always make me laugh.
He was a manic pixie dream boy.
Solid marriage is laughter.
But after a few years, everything just stopped being funny.
Why?
I was working all the time, and he was always between jobs. I hardly ever got to see the kids, and on the nights I would try to get home early to be with him. Something would go wrong, the house would be wrecked, and I'd have to clean it up. He never knew, but so many nights I just cried myself to sleep.
Really?
The truth is, I didn't like who I was when I was with him. I would turn into this horrible person. I didn't want my kids growing up with a mother like that.
Yeah, I'm sure you get that a lot.
Daniel, I'm better. And I'm sure he's better when he's not with me.
Well, you never... I mean, did you ever say anything to him, dear?
I love the way Robin Williams
Daniel
plays it.
Daniel doesn't like to talk about anything serious.
When he's getting more emotional, it's closer to his voice. Mm-hmm. It's less Mrs. Doubtfire.
I used to think Daniel could do anything except be serious. But then I was serious enough for everybody.
Beautiful character beats in that entire scene. So this is polarization, you know, especially you see this. A lot of couples who they get together because they're opposites and they are drawn to the differences. Once they have a family, it becomes problematic because, you know, if one person is too strict, then the other person becomes too lenient,
right?
You know, to kind of counterbalance that. And then the other person becomes stricter because this person's goofing off and there's no structure.
Sure.
Or at least that's how they see it. And then back and forth until they just grow way over here.
Yeah.
And that's what happened in this marriage. And when she talks about, I used to think Daniel could do anything except for be serious. And then I was serious enough for everybody. But there's moments you see throughout the film that, true to the script, you see Sally Field being more playful after the divorce. You see these little moments of levity, these little moments because she can allow herself.
She can relax.
Yeah.
She's been on her guard for so long that she hasn't been able to do that. And now she can actually relax and open up and be a better person, a different person.
Yeah. And then Daniel, for his part, like the whole arc of Robin Williams' character in this is by being Mrs. Doubtfire, he becomes the parent he always should have been.
Yeah.
Right? Which we'll circle back to which is why we have a happy ending, but not a Hollywood happy ending. We have a happy ending that feels real because of the character arcs, but we'll get there.
Yes.
GoldenEye era Brosnan, like...
Four iced teas, Todd.
2 years later.
At the peak of his Brosnance.
Miranda Hillard's.
Miranda Hillard?
Mm-hmm. The woman I'm seeing.
No kidding. You? A guy who's never having kids? Won't have anything to do with kids? You won't even date a woman with kids.
Exposition much?
Change, Ron. I'm pushing 40. I don't want to spend the rest of my life
pushing
myself.
40.
She's got an awful lot of baggage, though. Three kids.
Three terrific kids, and I'm crazy about them. Especially that little Natalie. Look at her. She's a sweet pie. God knows. They need some kind of stable father figure in their life right now. Thanks, Todd.
Oh, what about their real father?
Yeah. What can I say, Ron? The guy's a loser. I'll see ya.
Loser.
Yeah. Oh, sir. I saw it. Some angry member of the kitchen staff. Did you not tip them? Oh, they're around that way. It was a run by fruiting.
I'll it was a them, run sir. By Don't worry. Fruiting?
Oh. Oh, good waste of juice.
Loser.
What are you looking at?
Okay, it is a testament to Robin Williams' performance as Mrs. Doubtfire that when you hear his voice coming out of himself as Mrs. Doubtfire, it sounds dubbed.
Yeah.
Because he's done such a good job for so long at that point that when a man's voice comes out of that body, you're like, that's not right.
You're like, oh yeah. Oh,
Robin
yeah,
this... Williams is dubbing over this. Oh, wait.
It looks like he threw the fruit and actually hit him in the head.
I wonder how many takes they did of that. Because this is they didn't really have CG at this point to just like put in a lime. My guess is they just did 20 takes until they got it.
I look at this and, you know, how do you cope when your ex is moving on?
Right.
You know, I think it's
typically by throwing limes.
I read somewhere that they were, I know where it was. It was IMDb, same as the rest of us. They were originally scripted Pierce Brosnan's character to be more of a douche and just to be like not a good guy. But they actually said it's more interesting if he's a legitimate competitor.
Yeah.
And he actually would be a good father figure.
It makes the story so much stronger.
Yeah.
To have, oh no, he's a good guy. He's also handsome AF.
Like, yeah.
I'd hit that, but like, I wouldn't. I'd snuggle with it.
It's time to learn about love.
But yeah, it's so much more compelling of a story. Because if it's just a horrible guy, then it's like, well, yeah, of course we want good guy to win.
Yeah.
But in this case, it's like, oh, maybe they're all better off.
Well, and also, you know, Daniel...
Also, he's rich.
Daniel has to grow.
Yeah.
Because if it's just some guy that's, like, a worse guy than Daniel, then...
Yeah, I'm obviously already better.
Yeah. But here, he's like, oh, I need to step up.
Right.
And actually be a parent here. So, obviously, plot mechanics, yada, yada, he's discovered. This is where the movie would fall apart if it hadn't put in the work, because there's no way there should be a happy ending here after all the deception and manipulation and lying he's done.
Correct.
And it's not just about how much he loves his kids. It's about how Sally Field saw Mrs. Doubtfire cooking meals, cleaning house.
She now knows, oh, Daniel's actually a great parent when he's acting.
No, she knows that he can be a responsible parent.
That's it. That's the message.
Chris, wait right over there. Everybody?
Meet the new nanny. They just want their dad. But the court said daddy's crazy.
Daddy.
Hi.
What's going on?
I'm here to pick you up.
Your dad's gonna take you for a few hours every day after school.
Really?
What about the courts? All that legal stuff.
Ask your mom.
I took care of it. No more supervised visits. No more court liaison.
Just us?
Just us.
Mara Wilson should get a check for $100,000 every year for the rest of her life just for that smile. That was adorable.
Go get Mr. Bear. Go get your stuff. Hurry up.
All right. Would you like to come in?
I'll wait outside.
Okay.
Thank you. See you.
Are you crying? Because I'm crying.
No. Why would I ever cry? That's not like me.
This scene makes me cry because this is the way it should be. And whenever it is like this, it's beautiful.
It's great, yeah.
Because they had to work through some stuff. They've been bickering throughout the whole movie. They've been, but they see each other. Mm-hmm. And what I love about him being Mrs. Doubtfire, he sees her instead of, you know, this treacherous nag who broke his heart and broke up his family. He sees a woman that he has hurt.
Yes.
And that he's responsible for it, that and he needs to take accountability. And he sees the woman that he fell in love with, and he sees that she's happier without him. Not because he sucks, just because they're not a fit.
Right.
You know? And she sees a man who not just loves his kids because he loves to play with his kids, but really, truly wants what's best for them.
Yeah.
So how do we co-parent? We set aside whatever the problems were during the marriage, whatever the problems were in the relationship. That's why we divorced. It's over now. It's over here. Like, we're leaving it behind. The divorce was the solution to that problem.
Correct.
Right? It
created some different problems.
Right. And I'm not saying, like, divorce is always the way out. Obviously, I'm a couples therapist. I do that because I want to help couples stay together. But, like, it's not always feasible. But what is feasible is, okay, can we approach this maturely?
Yeah.
She says we have nothing in common at the beginning. And he says, sure, we do. We love each other. And here, they do have something in common. And it's that they love the kids. And I love the warmth with which they look at each other.
Yeah.
And it's not romantic love.
No, it's very clearly not romantic love. From both of them, you get a little tinge of sadness. Like, I remember what romantic love with you was like, and that was nice.
And it's sad we couldn't make it work.
Yeah.
Yeah. Lots of layers in these performances. But how do we make it work? We focus on what's best for the kids.
Yep.
And then we focus on our individual lives. We don't need to solve the things that didn't work in the marriage, because we couldn't solve them. That's why
it ended.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Dear Mrs. Doubtfire, 2 months ago, my mom and dad decided to separate. Now they live in different houses. My brother Andrew says that we aren't a real family anymore.
I'm assuming you included this because it's like the neatest, tidiest bow ever on a story.
Back together. Sincerely, Katie McCormick. Oh, my dear Katie. You know, some parents, when they're angry, they get along much better when they don't live together. They don't fight all the time, and they can become better people and much better mummies and daddies for you. And sometimes they get back together. And sometimes they don't, dear. And if they don't blame yourself. Just because they don't love each other anymore doesn't mean that they don't love you. Now, there are all sorts of different families, Katie. Some families have one mommy, some families have one daddy or two families. And some children live with their uncle or aunt, some live with their grandparents, or some children live with foster parents. And some live in separate homes and separate neighborhoods in different areas of the country, and they may not see each other for days, weeks, months, or even years at a time. But if there's love, dear, those are the ties that bind. And you'll have a family in your heart forever. All my love to you, Poppet. You're going to be all right.
One of the most beautiful things you can realize if your family is falling apart is that it's still a family. It just is taking a different shape.
True.
Right? Something I realized watching this film that I love about Robin Williams, that I think he does better than anybody. There are a lot of comedians who can be irreverent, you know, not like Robin Williams, because he's his own.
No one is like Robin Williams.
But there's lots of comedians who are irreverent, and then there's actors who can do straightforward sentimentalism.
Yeah.
But not a lot who can do both, because usually if you're irreverent, it's because you're eschewing or poo-pooing sentimentalism.
Yeah.
And he can go right for the heart of things
mm-hmm.
without blinking an eye at it, without turning down his nose at it, and it is real and genuine and powerful, and then he can take the piss out of things. And to be able to do both those things is an incredible skill.
Yeah. It's maybe unique among all actors was his ability to do that. And you nailed it on the head. The fact that he can, you know, deconstruct and be crass and crude and just in a heartbeat, just flip. And I think the reason so much of his comedy worked is because he was sentimental about things. And you could tell that there was love of the things that he was taking the piss out of. Like, it felt more real.
Divorce is really, really painful.
Yeah.
People go through hell.
Yeah.
And when you go through hell, it's easy to become bitter and to become angry. And we see that in these characters throughout the film, the bitterness and the anger that they have for one another. But as soon as they decide, we care about these kids, and the kids need us to be united for them, and the kids need us to get along, and to journey into perspective taking. I think one of the messages of this film is perspective taking leads to letting go.
Yeah.
It leads to forgiveness. And if some things are unforgivable, at least we let go of the bitterness, right? And honestly, for all the silliness, there's a beauty to Mrs. Doubtfire. And I think that's why it's endured. Because there are a lot of comedies that are funny that people forget about.
Sure.
But it's when it's funny and then it resonates. Those are the ties that bind, dear.
Oh, aren't they just?
So until next time.
I'm not a therapist, dear. I just see what I see.
I like that in a woman. Healthy. Natural. Just the way God made you.
Oh, dear Lord.
And watch movies.
Watch movies, dear.
Watch the movies, dear.
Oh, you'll love the movie. It was a run by fruiting. We want to thank our Patreon patrons, especially
Sophia, Kirsten Jomet,
Tammy Poitras, Diane, and Melanie Alexandra.
Thanks for supporting us over on our Patreon.